So let's talk about 8.1. We now have 8 minutes left, so I just talked for 3 more minutes. In 8.1, we're going to do a little bit of graphing, not too much, but I want you to notice some things that happen often between our graphs. So we're going to call these things linear functions because, well, what's linear mean?
Line?
Yeah, these are functions that make lines. So that's what we're going to be talking about here. And our first example, I'd like to graph a couple things. We're going to graph. You're familiar with that notation, we've already had that in this class. That just means f of x, it means a function. This thing's going to make a graph for us. F of x equals 3x. G of x equals 3x minus 4. What we're going to do is we're going to graph these functions on the same graph, and we're going to use some tables to make this up. So I know you've seen tables before because we've done it in here. When we make up a table, I told you that we're going to use how many points when we're talking about lines? Yeah, really you only need 2, but we want to make sure we have it right, so we're going to use 3 as kind of a check for us. And we want something negative, we want 0, we want something positive. We're going to use the same ones over here. Now, of course, we have f of x, not a y, but it works the same way. So on this column, we're going to put f of x. It stands for the y variable, or the dependent variable. And over here, we'll have g of x. Can someone explain to me how I get this column, what I do?
Replace x in 3 times -1.
Good, okay. So what this says is I want to plug in my independent variable of x, so -1. Whatever I get out of this is my f of x. Does that make sense to you? Mm-hmm. Okay, so we go, all right. We plug in -1, what are we going to get over here?
Negative.
Perfect. And that gives us a point, -1, -3. Awesome. If I plug in 0, if I substitute in 0, how much do I get?
Yeah.
Good, 3 times 0 is 0. And if I plug in 1, I'm going to get 3 out of that. 3 times 1 gives us our 3. And we have a 0.1, 3. Now, if we're to graph this on an xy axis, which I hope you remember how to do that, we just have to plot all 3 points, make sure it's a straight line, and then graph the thing. So when we plot -1, -3, hopefully you remember that means from the origin I go to left 1, down 3, and I put a point. 0, 0 says you're right at the origin. And 1, 3 says I go right 1, I go up 1 from the origin, and I put a point right there. We've done this before, so I'm going quickly through it because we've done this in the review. Does it look right to you? Look about like a straight line? If I'd had something like this, and then this, and then this, I'd probably have done something wrong. I mean, you want to go back and fix that. So here we've got about a pretty good looking straight line. Oh, that's good. Look at it. Isn't that fantastic? Oh, it's the best I've ever done. I'm so happy. This is the sort of thing math teachers get excited about. I know it's ridiculous, but this is it for us. Straight lines and good-looking parabolas. You don't even know what that is yet. Okay, so we have our first line, and what we do, and this is why we use the different names, like f of x and g of x, instead of just all being y, is now if we're going to draw this on the same graph, we can identify as this was the function f of x. So, oh, okay, that's my line f of x. Now when I put g of x up there, we'll be able to tell the difference between them. They'll be in different positions, and we'll say, oh, this came from this function, this came from this function. Does that make sense to you? Okay, now, as far as the g of x goes, we're going to do the same exact thing, so let's do this all together. This says we're going to plug in -1 to here. So you tell me what's 3 times -1?
-3.
And then -4.
-7.
So I'm going to get out -7 here. And I get the point -1, -7. If I plug in 0, I get 3 times 0 minus 4. That gives me what, folks? Good. So 0, -4. And I plug in 1, I get 3 times 1 minus 4. That is how much? How many will feel comfortable getting those points? Raise your hand if you do. Okay, good. So we're just plugging those numbers in. We're evaluating it. It's giving us a point out. If I plot those points, I have negative 1, negative 7. I have 0, negative 4. I have 1, negative 1. See, that was good. Make those bigger. There we go. And this is the graph g of x. Now, a couple things. Firstly, both these graphs are called functions because they pass something called the vertical line test. We're going to cover what the vertical line test is in more detail later on. But basically, if you imagine a whole bunch of vertical lines, verticals this way, every vertical line should touch each of these lines at only one spot. It means the graph can't ever double back on itself. Otherwise, it's not a function. So here, look at the black line, the f of x. Every vertical line touches that at only one spot. Every vertical line touches the g of x at only one spot. Do you see what I'm talking about? That means that these things are called functions. So that's great. Firstly, I want you to notice, there's two questions we're going to answer today. Do you see where these graphs cross the y-axis? Where's f of x cross the... Firstly, show me with your hands, what's the y-axis? This way? This way. Which one? Show me with your hands. Good. Yeah, look around. If you don't know, just kind of look around. Yeah, this is the y-axis. So I want to know, where do these graphs cross the y-axis? How about f of x? Where does it cross the y-axis?
Zero.
Okay, good. Cross right down here, y-axis, right at 0. How about g of x? Where does that cross the y-axis?
Negative 4,
okay. Now, we talked about this a little bit, but I want you to look back at the functions themselves, the equations. Do you see a coincidence here?
Parallel?
Before we even talk about that, I want you to look back at this. Do you see the similarities? What's similar between these two graphs? The 3x, okay. Notice how we have a 3x here, we've got a 3x here. Then we have, what's over here? How much is that? 0 over here, and we have a minus 4 over here. Look at where these things cross. This had minus 4, where does it cross on the y? That will always give you your y-intercept right there. That right there. Notice how this has 0. This doesn't have anything added or subtracted to or from it. That's going to cross at y equals 0. Look what it does. It says plus 0, cross at 0. Minus 4, cross at negative 4. How many will see that? Okay. One other thing, what makes these lines look the same? There's a word for that. The word about how lines go up or how lines go down. Say it louder. The slope. I want you to look and see about these lines. Are these lines ever going to intersect with each other?
No.
They're going up this, it's like walking stairs. The reason why the stairs work is because, in the same building, is because they go up at the same rate, right? So you can have several floors stacked on top of each other because if you walk upstairs, they're not like this. Because then you'd be like walking out and go, crap. You know? If your stairs weren't parallel, that's what would happen. Right? That wouldn't be very good at all. It'd be very short or something. Or do the limbo. But there's parallel still stairs. They're never, ever going to meet. And that's what's happening to these lines. So these lines are going up just like stairs do. The slope of each of these is exactly the same. In fact, we're going to learn that this number right here, that 3, represents the slope. And if we have the same exact slope, we have lines which are parallel. So these aren't ever going to meet because these two numbers, the 3 and the 3, are exactly the same. We're going to talk about the functions, linear functions, next time. Help you understand the introduction to graphs here. Good. Good deal. All right. So today, ladies and gentlemen, let's go ahead and continue talking about some linear functions. Now, what we were doing is we were figuring out that linear means line, so we're pretty much just graphing lines. And there's two types of equations we'll be using in this class. You've seen both of them, I'm sure, from your Math A, but I want to. It's worth repeating them. So there's two types of linear functions. The first one looks like this. Have you seen that form before? What's it called? You can all say it louder. This is the slope-intercept form. That's exactly right. You know, the thing about math is that sometimes the names aren't very creative. Like, this could be called the awesome function or the yellow function or something weird, but it's not. They're just pretty much named after what you need or what it gives you. So when you're talking about the slope-intercept form of a line, it's called slope-intercept because it gives you, well, the slope and the intercept. And we're talking about the y-intercept in this case. So the reason why this is called the slope-intercept is because it gives you the slope and the y-intercept. Which letter up here represents the slope? The M, that's right. So M is our slope. Hey, by the way, talking about slope, what is slope? See that letter for me?
Rise over run.
Like stairs, it's rise over run. If you ever work in construction, you're going to talk about the slope of a roof or the pitch of a roof, which is the same thing. It's how much the roof goes up compared to how much it goes over. If you have a very steep slope or a very steep roof, it's going to look like this. Like in the mountains, sometimes you see that, so the snow goes off of it. If you have a really, really shallow roof, it's going to be like that, right? Down here in the valley, we don't have very steep roofs compared to other parts of the country. Ours are like this. That's a slope of it, how much is going up compared to how much is going over. So when we talk about slope, what we really are talking about is the comparison of how much the line is going up or down compared to how much it's going over. Or rise over run is how you normally say that. The run isn't like you're jogging, right? You're not jogging. It's how much you're going over to the right. That's what the run is denoting here. What's our intercept? Is it the X, the Y, or the B? The X and the Y, those are just our variables because we have two axes, right? The X axis and the Y axis. That gives us directions on how to make our line. So M is our slope. B is not just any intercept, it's not the x-intercept, it's the y-intercept. That's the one that we talk about most often. So B stands for the y-intercept. And if you remember from our last example yesterday, we had a form like this, and we found out, we graphed two of them, we found out that this number, and sure enough, gives us the y-intercept, gives us where it's crossing the y-axis, and this number right here gave us our slope. In the previous example, that number was the same, stating that we had parallel lines. They were going up at the same rate. Another example, if you need one here. That line right there, is that line in slope-intercept form? If you have y on one side, and then we have x plus some number, you're in slope-intercept form. Now, what I'd like to do is figure out what is our slope and what is our y-intercept. Firstly, the easy one, what's the y-intercept here?
3.
Good, just that number off to the back. 3 is our y-intercept. What that means for us, we're going to graph this line at the same time, because when you do slope-intercept, man, it's so nice to graph those lines. You don't need a table. You don't need that t-table to plug in points. You don't have to do that. How many points do you need to graph a line?
2.
We usually use 3 on the table just to make sure we haven't done anything wrong, but how much do you need, like bare minimum?
2.
Barely, yeah, just 2. Here's how you can graph a line. I'm just going to give you one example because you have seen this before. Here's how you can graph a line directly from your slope-intercept. Okay, if you're not catching this, go back and watch this video again because this is it. This only takes like one or two times to really explain how you do it. If you have your slope and you have your y-intercept, you can graph any line. You start with your y-intercept, which in our case was what up here, everybody?
3.
Mm-hmm. We all clear on the 3, right? Mm-hmm. Like getting that 3 from right here, that is our y-intercept. The y-intercept says where you're crossing your y-axis. So where we are crossing our y-axis, is it positive 3? We go to positive 3, we put a point. That's our y-axis, that's our y-intercept. So far, so good? Okay. Now, what's our slope? Oh, so it goes with that sign as well, right? So that negative up front, that matters. Here's how you use your slope in conjunction with your y-intercept to graph your line. Now, our slope is negative 1/2. Can you tell me what is the rise of this slope?
Negative 1.
The rise is negative 1. If the rise is negative 1, are we going up or are we going down? Going down. What's the run? The run is 2. Listen, the negative or the lack of a negative tells you whether you're going up or down. You will always, I hope you're listening to this, you will always go to the right. Always. You are never going to go to the left. You're always going to go up or down, depending on positive, negative, and then to the right. Not sure if you're with me on that. Always to the right. That's how run works. The negative tells you down. Down how many?
One.
And then over to the right, how many?
Two.
This is what this tells you to do. Now, the question is, where do I do this from? Do I do this from my origin, or do I do this from the point that I just plotted? Yeah, from the point. We need 2 points, right? Here's one of them. The slope tells you how to get from point to point. That's what this does. So if I have a point at 3, positive 3 on the y-axis, how to get to my next point says, oh, you're going to go, look at, down, because it's negative, down 1, that's my rise, and then over to the right 2. So from my point that I just plotted, I go down 1, I go over 2, and we do that in combination, and then we put a point. You don't put like 14 little points over here every time you move. You just go down 1, over 2, and then you put your point. So here is my y-intercept at 3. I went down 1. I went to the right 2, because we always go to the right 2, and I put another point. Is that enough for me to make my line? Yeah, it looks like it. I could keep going, right? I could go down 1, over 2, down 1, over 2. But it's always going to make a straight line for us. So as long as we do this correctly the first time, we've got it. Oh, not as good as yesterday. Not even close. Do you remember yesterday? Not so much. Anyway, this is good enough for us right now. I want you to notice something and compare this to what we did yesterday. Yesterday, our graph was going like this, right? Do you remember that? And we had a positive 3x there. On this graph, we're going down. Why is that? So positive slope, we're going to go up. Negative slope, we're going to go down. That should make sense to us, right? Positive means we're always climbing. Negative means we're always falling. We're always going to the right, so that tells us whether we're going to be a graph going upwards or a graph going downwards. Let me show what we just talked about, the whole slope graphing thing. Good, okay. Now, the second form of equation that we're going to get, we're going to be using this one a lot in this class. Is that one. So we have another form. It's obviously not slope-intercept because we just talked about this. This also is not very original. I mean, the name, it's not a cool name or anything. It's just a name based on what you need to make this function of. And what you need to make this function of is, well, tell me a letter up here that you recognize besides the x and the y. These x and the y, that is your variable right there. What's another letter up here that you know? What's your m? So it's going to have a slope in it somewhere. The other thing, the x1, the y1, what's that mean? Well, anytime that you see an x with a little 1 there and a y with a little 1 there, or anything with a subscript, not a superscript like an exponent, a subscript here, that stands for an actual point, like a specific point. X and y will be your variables. This stands for some point, like 2, 3, or -1, 4. That's a specific point. So what this is this is a point, this is the slope, this is called point slope. Very original, right? So this was slope intercept because it had the slope, then the intercept. This is point slope because you have a point and the slope. M is still your slope, which is rise over run. And x1, y1 is a specific point. So some specific point on the line. Point on the line. You know, there's one more that I will talk about. Let's call this form number 3. These are the two major ones that you're going to be working with. Form number three is kind of a, it's a nice little easy thing. There's not a whole lot of work you can do, you just need to recognize it. It's when y equals a constant. When y equals a constant, we talked about this a while back in your appendix, your review section. If y equals a constant, is there an x variable? Which means you cannot have an x-intercept. No crossing this axis right here. If you don't cross this axis right here, how's your line going to look?
Horizontal.
Yeah, it can't possibly be like this, can it? Or like this. Or like this. It's got to be horizontal. So y equals c is going to be a horizontal line. In fact, do you have an m?
Yes.
If you don't have an m, your slope is zero. So your m or your slope is zero, meaning that you're not rising, you're not falling, you're just like this. So you're horizontal. So hopefully that logic makes sense to you. If there's no slope, the slope is zero. If there's a slope is zero, that would be infinite slope. This would be infinite slope right here. That would be horizontal slope, or a slope of zero. So we're a horizontal line. So there's no slope, m or slope equals zero. This means we're a horizontal line. Question, do we have a y-intercept? Are we going to cross the y-axis?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Sure, horizontal line will cross the y-axis. Where?
Where the constant is.
Sure. So the constant says you're always this number, right? So if y equaled 3, we'd always be at 3. If y equaled 7, we'd always be at 7. So we're going to cross at, well, that specific number. So the y-intercept will be 0, comma c. 0 for the x, and then c for the y-intercept. We cross at that constant. Maybe we'll practice a couple of those in just a bit. And by the way, let's try something really fast. Let me make sure that you understand these equations here, these forms. Let's see if we can write the equation that has a slope of negative 2 and a y-intercept of 0, 3 fourths. The 0, 3 fourths just says you're on the y-axis. The 0 says you're going over on the x, and the 3 fourths says you're going up 3 fourths on the y. So that, therefore, is our y-intercept. Which form is going to be of the best use for us? Let's look over here. Is it going to be y equals a constant? Is our slope equal to 0, specifically? What's your slope in this example? Okay, so we're certainly not horizontal. We are going either up or down, okay? What was the slope again?
Negative.
Okay, very good. So we have to choose between the slope-intercept and the point-slope. Now, here's how you choose. This does have a point, and it does have a slope, but you want to be as specific as you can. Do we have the y-intercept in our case? Does it say y-intercept up there?
Yes.
So you have the y-intercept. If it didn't say y-intercept or it didn't give you a zero comma number, you'd be right here using point slope. In fact, if you really want to, you can do this problem with point slope. This one will always work for you, provided you have the slope and a point. It's fine. But we can make this a little bit easier. We can do slope-intercept. So we just need to identify what is our m and what is our b. What is our m up here, ladies and gentlemen?
Negative.
Good, because that's our slope. And somebody else, can you identify the b? The b would be the value of the y-intercept. How much is the y-intercept?
0.4.
Good. Let's see if we have enough to do this. We have the m, we have the b. What goes in place of the y and the x? Anything? Those are your variables, right? That's how you make the rest of your line, just by plugging in x's and getting out y's. So you don't plug anything in for those. So we'd say, okay, Well, y equals, we're going to substitute in the negative 2 for the m. We're going to substitute in the 3/4. Since the 3/4 is positive, we're going to put plus. If it had been negative 3/4, we would be putting minus 3/4. That's our equation of our line that's in the slope-intercept form, because we were given the slope and the y-intercept. But you had to feel all right with that example. Good, okay. Now, are you always given the slope, and are you always given the y-intercept?
No.
Rarely. Not often at all. I mean, this is a very basic example, because I gave you both parts to that formula, that function. So, typically, what you're given are just 2 points. And so, if we're going to find the equation of a line like we just did, and you're given 2 points, and you're not given a slope, well, we first better find a way to find the slope. Isn't that right? You with me? Let me make something very clear to you. When you're finding the equation of a line, the minimum you must have is a point and a slope. If you don't have a point and a slope, listen, point, slope, right? You need this and this. You're rarely going to be given this and this. Rarely. That was a very special case. We typically use this one and make it look like this one later. That's what happens. So you're always, almost always, going to be using point slope. So what do you need to make the line? You need the point and you need the slope. Okay, that's the minimum. You have to have that. Not sure if you're understanding that. You've got to have that. So we have to find a way to find the slope. And that's what we're going to be doing. What I'd like to do is I'd like to invent this with you. Just so you're not like, well, that's a great formula, I have no idea what it means. Because I'm sure you've seen the slope formula before, but maybe no one's ever really talked you through how this is invented. So what we're going to do is we're going to find the slope between any 2 points. When something in math says between any 2 points, it doesn't mean specific points, like find the slope between 1, 3 and 4, 5. Okay, it means that I want to come up with a formula so that I can plug any 2 points in there and it gives me the correct slope, right? Because we don't want to have to reinvent the slope formula every single time we do a problem. That would be totally lame. Totally lame. So what we're going to do is, instead of giving specific points, we're going to pick like general points. So we can't use specific numbers. But wait a second. If I pick two general points like this, I say this isn't 1, 2, and this isn't like 7, 5 or whatever it is. If I say these are two general points, how in the world can we label these things? How's every point in the world look? Every point in the world has a certain form to it.
XY?
Yeah, XY. Okay, what's the X coordinate here? Can you give me one?
X1.
Okay, so can we use a number like 2? The answer is no, not if we're talking about any 2 points, right? Because as soon as I do this, I say, oh, this is 2, 3. As soon as I do that, is that any point?
No.
That's a specific point. I can't have a specific point here. Because if I do, it's only going to work for that specific point. Do you get me on that? So I got to have a general point. How we have general points is every single point you've ever seen has this form. It looks like xy. True? And this point will look like xy. But we have to have some way to tell the difference between this xy and that xy, because right now they look identical, right? And so I think Jacob already said it. We're going to use a subscript here, just like we have over here, this x1 and this y1. We'll say, okay, let's call this the first point. This will be x1, y1. And this will be the second point, x2, y2. Are you guys okay with that notation? Not sure if you are. Yeah? Okay, good. So we've got these 2 points. Are they general points? Yeah. Because we haven't said any specific values for these things. We just have x1, y1, x2, y2. Notice how the ones have to go together and the twos have to go together. It's because it's the first point and that's our second point. Now, what we do for our slope is we look for our, what was slope again? 1 over what? We look for a rise over 1. So we need to somehow figure out the rise and the run to these two points. Okay, let's kind of go over something again. What's the rise? Is the rise option number one or option number two? Rise goes from here. So what we're looking at specifically is how much does this line gain in altitude between this point right here and this point? True? Okay, this is going to be our rise. From here to here. Well, let's see if you're good at this. Oh, I hope you are. I hope you're good at this. What I need to know, how high is that? How high is that?
It's between Y1 and Y2.
It's between Y1 and Y2? This is zero, right? The height is zero. If this point, tell me something. I'm going to erase this and just kind of follow along for a second, okay? If this point were 1, 2, let's pretend for a second that that point is 1, 2. You with me? How high would that be?
1, 1.
Really?
2.
Explain 2. Why 2?
That's the one.
Oh, I see. Okay, because we plot points by going x, y, right?
Yes.
I hope. Please? Yeah, we plotted lots of points in here, right? We plot points by doing x, y. So our x would be 1 in this case, our y would be 2. True? Okay, if this was 3, 5, there's no scale on this, so you have no idea what it is. But if this is 3, 5, what would our height be there? Okay, you're all clear. Now, it's not 1, 2, it's not 3, 5, it is x1, y1. What's my height? X1 or Y1?
Y1.
Certainly Y1. We're on the Y-axis, folks. This height is Y1. Okay, with that in mind, what is this height up here?
Y2.
Certainly, yeah. It's got to be the Y value, right? Because we're working on the Y-axis. That makes sense. Okay, we've already done the hard part. What's, since this is our rise, this direction has to be our run, right? This is our run to the right. What's this over?
X1.
That's got to be x2. So far, so good? People understand the notation there, feel right about that. Good. Now, the only thing we have to do now is figure out what's the distance here and what's the distance here. I'll give you a very good example something to illustrate this for you. Let's pretend again that this was 10 and this was, oops, not 7, let's say 3. That doesn't look like a 7, looks like a 3 to me. Let's say that's 10, that's 3. Could you tell me how far between these, what's the distance between these numbers?
7.
How'd you figure that out?
Subtract.
Yeah, you probably didn't go 3. 7. You don't do that to find a distance. If you did, I'd say, what's the distance between 137 and 42? And you'd go, oh, 40. And you'd be there for another 3 minutes doing that. We don't do distances like that. We do distances by what you did very quickly. You said, oh, there's a 10 here, there's 3 there. The distance between them must be 7, because I subtract them. True? So this rise would be 10 minus 3. Now, of course, that's how we figure out the rise. You take the big one, minus the small one, that gives you the distance between them. Sure, no problem. Now, it's of course not 10, and it's not 3. It's what? Minus what?
Y2.
That's our rise. 10 minus 3, I'm going to erase that, because we don't actually have 10 minus 3. I was just illustrating that for you. But the real rise that we have is whatever the y2 is minus whatever the y1 is, that's going to give me my change in the height, or change in y. Now, if you're following that. Good. Now, let's do the same thing with this distance. I'm not going to do the 3 and the 10 again. Kind of have that idea. What's the distance between x1 and x2? Can you tell me that? Sure. Whatever this one is minus whatever this one is will give us the distance between them. So let's kind of recap just a little bit so you kind of are with us one more time. What we do to make a formula is you use something called general points. You don't have a specific point here. We have any point, x1, y1. We have any other point, x2, y2. Notice how I use the first quadrant, but I could be anywhere on this graph. It really doesn't matter. This isn't even to scale. So I'm really making up general points. That way this will work with any two points that you give me. To find the rise, because our slope is rise over run, we're going to take the top y, the highest y we can find, minus the smallest y we can find. So basically, the second y minus the first y, just because in this case, this one was higher. Now, could you have done it the other way? Yeah, it really doesn't matter which order you go, provided you stick with the same point for your at y2 and for your x2. All right, you can't switch that up. The twos have to go together, y's have to go together. So for our rise, we say, okay, we're going to take this y2 minus this y1. That's giving us the height between them. We're going to take this x2 minus this x1. That's giving us the length that these guys are running. So we have now our rise. We've got our run in distance using our y2 minus y1 and our x2 minus x1. Here's the neat part. Since slope is rise over run, do we have an expression for the rise? Do we have an expression for the run? Let's substitute that. What's the letter we use for slope, by the way?
M.
Okay. So I'll use M again. M is rise over run. We already knew that from a long time ago. The rise here is, we already did it. The run, we have that here. And we've just invented the slope formula. Have you seen that formula before? Hey, you probably have. Has anyone ever showed you that, how to do that? Maybe, maybe not, but if you have, then this is a repeat, but if you haven't, this is how you invent the slope formula. It's really not that hard. You just pick some general points and understand what rise and what run is. How many people were able to follow that down? Now, I'm never going to have you actually go through and prove the slope formula for me, okay? You don't have to do that. So if you wrote down, great. What I have to have you do is take any two points, use that formula, and find out the slope between them. So let's go ahead and practice that right now. So let's find the slope between the following two points. Find the slope between those two points. This is important because if we wanted to write the equation between these two points, we would need the slope. And right now all we're given is two points. It's great, we have at least a point, but we need the slope here as well. That's why we do that whole process. Let's go, wait a second, Mr. Leonard. That says y2, y1, this says x2, x1. I don't have any of those x2, x1, y2, y1s up here. How do we identify those? And the answer is, well, you kind of get to pick. It doesn't matter what point you start with, and in some cases, starting with the correct point is going to make your slope formula a little bit easier because of some certain numbers and pluses and minuses. Sometimes you can pick a better point, but in general, it doesn't matter what you pick. You're going to get the same slope no matter what. You have to be very good at signs, though, adding, subtracting negatives, and dividing negatives. Okay, you got to be good at that. So up here, when we have this, like I said, you can pick which one you want to start with. Now, because it's, I'm just going to go ahead and pick x1 to be, what would you pick x1 to be?
3.
Well, why 3 and not like 0?
Because that would be y1.
Okay, so you have to pick x for x. I mean, you got to have an x value. So either one of these could be our x1. It really doesn't matter. I'm going to stick over here because, well, I like to go in order. That's the type of person I am. Now, after you pick one x1, everything else has to fall in place. So if this is x1, what's that have to be for sure?
Y1.
Good. It is a y, and it's got to be the first one because these are grouped together. You can't go x1, y2. It doesn't make sense. You can't go x1, x2. That's certainly not an x component. So we do x1, y1. If this is x1 and this is y1, what's this one?
X2.
Good and perfect. Now we have enough to substitute into that formula that we just created, and that's going to find the slope for us. So to find the slope, we go, okay, I know we're supposed to do y2 minus y1. In our case, our y2 is what?
4.
So we're going to take, instead of y2, we're going to put in 4, because that is my y2. Now, do we add or do we subtract?
Subtract.
Okay, good. We have to always subtract those things. So we will put a minus. Y2 minus y1, what's our y1 in our case, ladies and gentlemen?
Zero.
So we're going to have 4 minus 0. I'm just, if you're still with them, where those numbers are coming from. That's not magic, right? I mean, we're just taking these numbers, we're putting it in there for our y2 minus our y1. Over, oh my gosh, x2 minus x1. What's our x2?
Negative 2.
Good, so that has to go here. Notice how you have to stick in this in the correct order. If you reverse these ones accidentally, your slope is going to be changing from this to this, or this to this. You're going to get the opposite slope of what you want. That's not a good thing, okay? It's going to make your line look completely different. Instead of going upwards, it would be going downwards or vice versa. So if you're starting with this point, you have to start with this point for your y's and your x's. So we do 4 minus 0, and we go back to this point. We do negative 2 minus 3. That's why we write this out. So we have that in our mind. We can see it on the paper. That's how you do your slope. So try that. On your paper, try writing these things out when you're doing your slope. Negative 2, and then we put the minus sign, and what comes next? You're going to get very good at this. And in getting very good at this, you're going to think that you don't need to show all the work and kind of do this in your head. Let me warn you, when you go quickly on slope, that's kind of where the mistakes happen, okay? So take your time on the slope portion. It's very similar to doing a simplification problem with those rational expressions and rushing through the factoring. Some of you saw that on your test. When you rush through the factoring and you get the wrong factorization, your problem didn't work out so good, does it? Even though you think you might be doing it right, it's going to end poorly for you. Same thing happens with your slope. Okay, take your time on your slope. Make sure you have this part right. Okay, so we have 4 minus... Oh, what's our 4 minus 0?
4.
We're going to have 4. Okay, very good. And we have negative 2 minus... What's negative 2 minus 3?
Negative 5.
Perfect. 4 over negative 5. Now, I do have to tell you, it doesn't really matter where that negative goes, but we typically will write the slope with a negative out front, or the negative on the 4. Because we like to identify that negative as being our rise, with our rise, the run is always going to be going to the right. So I'm going to rewrite this just slightly. I'm going to write it negative 4 over 5. Show me with your hands, should our graph be going upwards like this, or should it be going downwards like this? What do you think?
Downwards.
Why downwards?
Yeah,
that's negative. That's a negative slope right there. This slope is going to be dropping as we go from left to right. What is our rise on this graph? So we're going to be dropping 4 and then going to the left or right?
Right.
How many?
5.
Yeah, that's how we go from point to point. You go from every point, down 4 over 5, down 4 over 5. It's like a staircase. That's how this is sloped. How many learners should have a fine slope? Let's take this one step further. So now we have the slope. What I want to do after this is, with the same problem, I'd like to write the equation between these two points. So find the slope between this, dot, 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 and then write the equation. So let's go through this. Ladies and gentlemen, do you think this is going to be a horizontal line? What do you think? Horizontal line?
No.
Horizontal line would have a slope of 0. Is this a slope of 0?
No.
That's certainly not horizontal then. Can I use slope-intercept? To use slope-intercept, you have to have the slope, which we have now, but you also have to have the y-intercept. Do you have the y-intercept?
No.
If you did, the y-intercept would be 0, something. We don't have 0. We have something, 0. We don't have 0, something. That's the y-intercept. Nod your head if you're with me on that. Okay, so we don't have those two forms that we can use. That leaves us with only one form we can choose. This is the form you are going to be using 90% of the time in this class. 98% of the time. 98 point, like a lot in this class. All right, you're going to be using point slope. because you're given a point and now you found a slope. So I rewrote that for you. So write the equation, use point slope, y minus y1 equals n, x minus x1. Let's see if we have what it qualifies to use point slope. Hey, it tells you what you need, right? You need a point, and you need, well, the slope. Do we have the slope? Great, we just found that. Do we have a point? In fact, we have 2 points. Well, wait a second. How do you choose which one to use? Well, firstly, it doesn't matter. But secondly, haven't you already identified a y1 and an x1? We can use that there. So really, after you do the slope, after you find that, it's already set up for you to use this problem. That's kind of, isn't that nice? Say yes, Mr. Leonard. That's very nice. Some stuff. Yeah, you already have a y1 and an x1. Now, can you change them? Sure, you could if you really want to. Some of you might be wondering, why in the world would you ever change these? Well, is it easier to work with zeros or with numbers? Zeros, typically, right? Because you can add zero and subtract zero very easily, right? So usually what people will do is they will set up their points in such a way that your x1 and your y1 are involving the most zeros. Bet you're happy with me on that. That's the easier way to do this. Okay, so now I've done that automatically, but if I had looked at this problem at the beginning and these points were reversed, I'd probably switch them before I did this. So I'd have my x1 and my y1 with the zeros. Not so much for the slope, but for this thing over here. That's what I was talking about earlier when I said you can set this up in certain ways to make it a little bit easier on yourself. Okay? If you didn't catch that, if that went over your head, then don't worry about it. This will work exactly the same way. You just set up x1, y1, x2, y2. You stick with your same x1, y1, and we can go from here. Okay, raise your hand if you're okay with this. Still against over here? Okay. Let's go ahead and let's substitute in some points then. Do I substitute anything in for this y right here?
No.
That is my variable. That's going to stay there no matter what. How about for, well, my minus stays in minus. How about the y1? What's my y1?
Zero.
Yeah. Good. So that's right here. I already have it labeled. Equals m. Oh, what's my m?
Zero.
How much?
-4/5.
Yeah, I just found that. Yeah, that's right here. I just found my m. So -4/5. Okay, great. So we have.
You write -3. It's in a zero.
And y1 is zero.
Oh. I don't know. I was testing you. Again. You guys are so good at this. I don't know why I did that. I was thinking zero. My hand, stupid hand, just kind of. It went like this instead of like this. Anyway. Yeah, it should certainly be zero. So we have our zero from our y1. You know, I looked at the three. We have our slope, our m. We just found that. That's -4/5. Let's fill in the rest of this. We've got our x. We're not going to plug anything for that x. That's our variable. We have our minus, and then what are we going to put for the x1?
Three.
Let's see if I can get this one right. We got it. Now just if you're okay getting from here to here. Good. It's already labeled for you. You just have to plug it in. Now we do some simple math, because what we're going to try to do is take this from point slope and get this into slope-intercept. The reason why we do that is because slope-intercept is generally easy to graph. We'd like to go to the intercept and use the slope to find the next point. So y minus, how much is y minus 0?
4.
Just y, yeah. Minus 0, that doesn't do anything. Wait a second, how do we do this? Yeah, that's pre-algebra stuff, but it's important to get this right, isn't it? So how you distribute, you take the number outside your parentheses with the sign. We distribute that into both terms. So -4/5 times x is going to give you, that's the easy one. The next one is a fraction. You have -4/5 times -3. -4/5 times -3. Firstly, you're going to get a plus or minus?
Plus.
Definitely a plus. How much is -4/5 times 3? Use your calculator if you have a fraction mode. Do it off the side if you don't. Do it in your head if you can. You take 4/5 times 3. Just do it off to the side here. 4/5 times 3, you know, you should know how to multiply some fractions here. 4/5 times 3 is what?
12/5.
So you have 3 over 1. You know how to multiply fractions together. You can have 12 over 5.
Could we have factored out the fraction before?
How do you mean?
Like, just times everything by 5?
You could, but you're going to end up with the same thing anyway because you'd have a 5y over here. Okay, you remember, when you multiply by 5, you do this side and this side. So you're going to have that 5y, you'll end up dividing with by it anyway. So either way, you're going to have this fraction. There's no way to really get rid of this one. That's a good question. Good idea, though. Good idea. You do all right with that fraction stuff. Good. Get used to those fractions, because you will get them doing your slope and your y-intercept. Could you still graph that?
Yeah.
What's my y-intercept? How much is 12 fifths? I'd go up 2 and 2 fifths, that's kind of an awkward number, right? And then I'd somehow go down 4 and to the right 5, which is what we talked about. I'd like you to try one, and we'll end with this. Actually, we'll end with some horizontal lines in just a bit. But go ahead and see if you can find the slope between these two points. And then use that to write the equation, all right? These go faster than what I've just shown you because I had to show you the work. Typically, they only take a couple minutes, which is nice. So try that between these two points. There you go. So to write the equation of a line, you need at minimum one point and the slope. Right now you're given 2 points. So the first thing you must do is, of course, you have to find the slope. So hopefully you've done that or you're working on that right now. Once you've found the slope, you'll have a point, and then you'll have a slope. You use what slope? We'll start in about one more minute. I also want you to end this in slope-intercept form, so that means you need to solve for y when you're done. Hey, by a show of hands, how many people picked this one to be x1? Anybody pick this one to be x1? Okay, are you going to get the same answers?
Yes.
Absolutely, you will. Now, which one might be easier? For the slope, it doesn't matter. For this, it'd probably be easiest to pick this one as your x1. The reason why, I want you to look at the formula. If this is x1 and this is y1, notice how you're plugging in a 0. You see that? Makes things easier over here. If this is x1 and this is y1, you're plugging in two numbers that you have to work with, and eventually you're going to have to add 2 to both sides. Do you see that? So at the end of your problem, most of you probably added 2 to both sides, right? If you picked the 0, you wouldn't have to do that. It's 0. Okay, it's y. So if that's over your head, you stick with what you're doing. But it will make things easier if you pick the most zeros for your x1, y1. Now I'm going to do it this way because more people picked this way. So x1, y1, x2, y2, we're going to find our slope first. That's what we have to start with. So we're going to have 0 minus 2. We're going to have 2 minus negative 1. How many people have it exactly like that on the paper with the minus and the negative? Good, that's important. We take our 0 minus the 2, 2 minus, that minus has to be there no matter what this is, that just happens to be negative 1. So we have a minus and a negative. What's that minus the negative do? So this is negative 2 over 3. Again, is this graph climbing or falling from left to right? Good, just go like this. That's exactly right. Now we have our slope, which is great. We've got two points. One of them is already outlined as x1, y1, so we can go ahead and use this formula now. We're going to have y minus y1. In our case, y1 happens to be 2. So I'm going to have y minus 2. Are you still with me? Good. Equals m. We just found our m. Make sure you have the negative. 2/3. X minus what?
-1.
Like this?
No.
That would be x minus 1. This is x minus negative 1. That looks horrible. X minus negative 1. Let's do a little work on this thing. We do y minus 2. We have negative 2/3. We're going to have x plus 1. This is great if you're asked to leave it in point slope form. Okay, if your teacher ever asks you, give me this in point slope form, you're done. That's awesome. If you aren't supposed to write this in slope intercept form, you have some more work to do. Specifically, you need to distribute, and then you're going to have to add 2 like we were talking about at the beginning of this example. So negative 2/3 x, this is kind of nice. Negative 2/3 times 1 is just minus 2/3. So far so good? You sure? So we distribute that right there. We get negative 2/3 x minus 2/3. Lastly, you have to get y by itself, which means you're going to add 2 to both sides. So y equals, we have negative 2/3 x. That's from here. We have negative 2/3 plus 2. Oh my gosh, how do you do negative 2/3 plus 2? Well, right off to the side. Do negative 2/3, it has to go with the sign, plus 2. Of course, we mean plus 2 over 1. You need a common denominator. This is just adding fractions from a long time ago. I can't spend a whole lot of time doing this in this class, but you multiply 3 over 3, just like you did with rational functions. You would have plus 6/3, which is equivalent to 2. You combine those together, and you get positive 4/3, so you're going to put plus 4/3. And from here, you should be able to identify that our y-intercept is 4/3, our slope is negative 2/3, and we're good to go. If you had to graph this thing, you could certainly do it. How many people feel okay with that example? How many people got at least the slope? Raise your hand if you got at least the slope. How many people made it all the way down to here? Good. The last thing, it'd take me 10 seconds to talk about this. If you were to write the equation of a horizontal line containing, horizontal line means there's no slope, the slope is 0. Well, I shouldn't say there's no slope. The slope is 0, and it's always the constant of y. So all you have to do with this thing, if it's horizontal, you go, oh, okay. Horizontal means y equals something. What's y equal? Look at your point. What is y equal here? That's your line. Okay. That's the equation of a horizontal line. It says y equals the constant. That 6 is never going to change. Can you tell me, without even trying really, y equals what here? That's the horizontal line containing that point. It will contain every point that ends with a negative 2. That's how you do your horizontal lines. Did today make sense for you guys? Good, okay. So the example we're going to start with is the one on the board. We're going to try to write the equation of a line containing the point negative 1, 2, and parallel to a given equation. Now, when we're talking about making the equation of a line, you always need two things. What are the two things you need to write the equation of a line? You definitely need the slope. That's one of them. What's another thing you need? You gotta have a point. You don't necessarily need the y-intercept, but you have to have at least a point. So when we're talking about this, in order to write the equation of a line, you must have a point and the slope. got to have a point and a slope. And the reason is, 95% of the time, we're going to be using the point-slope form of a line, right? We need a point, we need the slope. If you have those two things, you have the equation of a line. Are you with me on this so far? Andrew, are you okay? So you've got to have those two conditions, otherwise you can't make an equation. Now, a couple nice things about this. First thing is, a point will always be given to you. You have to be given a point, otherwise you can't do the problem. So therefore, anytime you get a test or you get a problem on your homework, it's going to have at least one point. So the point will be given. At least one point's always given. But you might have to find the slope. It could be given to you, but that's kind of rare for us. When you're first talking about equations, like back in Math A, yeah, they give you the slope almost all the time, right? Because you really rarely have to find it. But now, when we're in Math C, well, you're going to have to find the slope in most cases. So step one, point number one, is point's always given, but the slope you might have to find. Now, it could be given to you. If that's the case, then you have kind of a break, right? If you've given the slope, then you don't have to do a whole lot of work. So it might be given. But more likely, you're going to be given one of these latter two situations. Either you're going to have the situation that we dealt with yesterday where I give you 2 points. Do you remember yesterday where I gave you the 2 points and we found the slope between those 2 points? And then we made the equation of the line? That's a very common thing to do. Sometimes instead of like this, I would have just 2 points up there. I say use the slope formula, it's going to give you the slope. Then we use that in conjunction with our point slope and we get the equation of a line. That's what, if you started your homework, that's what was on some of your homework. Did you start your homework? Good, so you probably saw that. So the slope might be given. You might have to use this. If you're given 2 points, if I do that, then you use a slope formula. So let's check out this example. We're trying to write the equation of a line that's contained in a certain point, so automatically our point's given. That's awesome. I told you that would always happen. You're always going to be given a point. But then we also have to find the slope, because the two things we need to write the equation of a line are a point and the slope. We have the point. The next thing is we got to find the slope. So let's take a look at this. Is the slope just directly given to you, like it says, slope is this?
No.
Am I given 2 points?
Yes.
Two points.
No.
Let's say here's 1 point, here's another point. Am I given that?
No.
Okay, so there's got to be a third situation. If you're not directly given the slope, and you don't have 2 points by which you can find the slope, there's got to be a third situation. And the third situation is, you might be given another equation. Are we given another equation?
Yeah.
Okay. We need to be able to find the slope from that equation. That's our third option. So if it's given, great, easy. If you have 2 points, you know what to do. That's a slope formula. If not, you will be given an equation. So we have to solve for y so that we can find the slope from that equation. So if given an equation, solve that for y. Put it in slope-intercept form. Why might we want to put that in slope intercept form? Why would that be the case? Would that help us find the slope? What letter represents the slope up here? So as soon as we do that, hey, you get your slope. That's the idea. So our idea is, if the slope's given, great. If you're given 2 points, then we're going to use the slope formula. So we got this situation again. We have slope might be given. If you're given 2 points, find the slope using the slope formula. Otherwise, you're going to be given an equation. Solve that for y, put it in slope-intercept form, because then you can identify the slope from that equation and use that in the ways that we're going to talk about right now. So what am I talking about, the ways that we're going to talk about that right now? Well, there's two things that you're going to be doing on these problems. We're going to be trying to write equations that are parallel or perpendicular to a given equation. Tell me something about lines which are parallel.
They never cross.
They never ever do. We actually had an example of that the very first part of this chapter. Lines which are parallel, well, they look like staircases. They never ever, they never touch. Why don't they touch? Say that again?
They have the same slope.
Yeah, they do. The slope meant rise over run. So if our lines are going up at the same rate all the time, they're like stairs. They're never, ever going to touch. So what we know from just thinking about these lines is that parallel lines always have the same slope. Parallel lines have exactly the same slope. They're going to go up or down at the same exact rate, meaning they're never going to touch, and meaning by definition that they are not going to be, or that they're going to be parallel. Now there's one other one that we have to talk about. We're going to do an example of this a little bit later. We also have to talk about perpendicular lines. Perpendicular lines. Have you heard of the word perpendicular before?
Yes.
Parallel is pretty common, right? When we know parallel, they just don't touch. Perpendicular is a little bit different. Do perpendicular lines touch?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. At how many points?
One.
Okay, two lines can only intersect at one point, right? They don't double back on each other, so that's good. But they intersect at a very specific, in a very specific way. How do perpendicular lines meet? Do they meet like this? Is that perpendicular? Mm-hmm. Stop me when you get to perpendicular.
Stop.
Which one?
When they get a 90 degree.
That's right. When you have a perfect cross and every angle is 90 degrees, that means perpendicular. So perpendicular doesn't mean like this. That's not perpendicular. All right, that would mean at some obtuse angle and an acute angle, that doesn't make a perpendicular set of lines. How you think of perpendicular is maybe these walls. This wall and the floor meet at a perpendicular angle. That's why they stand up straight, because it's at 90 degrees. If it was off a little bit, those people over there would probably be dead, right? Because this building would go, or on this side, it would go. And that wouldn't be too good for us, would it? No. So walls are perpendicular. Perpendicular means lines which are meeting at 90 degrees. So when we talk about perpendicular lines, we're talking about this situation. You put a little box there signifying that it's 90 degrees. That's what that says. Now, let me ask you a question. Are perpendicular lines going to have the same slope? Oh, okay, so if they were perpendicular lines, if they're parallel lines, they would have the same slope. Naturally, that would make them parallel. So perpendicular can't have the same slope. They're going to be very, very much like opposite. But if I have -3 and +3, those aren't going to be perpendicular either. To find perpendicular lines, the slopes are actually not just opposites, but they're also reciprocals. Remember that reciprocation that you do with division of fractions? You reciprocate that and you multiply? That same reciprocation is how you find perpendicular slopes. So in order to find perpendicular lines, we're going to have to look for slopes that are not only negative of each other, but also reciprocals of each other. Negative reciprocals. So perpendicular lines have slopes which are negative reciprocals.
Will the slopes ever both be negative, or will one always be positive and the other be negative?
When you have perpendicular lines, mm-hmm. One will be positive and one will be negative. Think about it this way, right? If you have perpendicular lines, the only time it doesn't have is the case is when you have a horizontal line and a vertical line, all right? Then 1, 0, 1's undefined. We rarely talk about that case. If you have perpendicular lines, though, if one's going up like this, the other one has to be going down to meet it at 90 degrees. If one's going down, the other's half, that's hard to do, shoulder. The other has to be going up, right? It has to be. So one will be positive, one will be negative. That has to happen. That's a good question. So perpendicular lines, they have slopes which are negative reciprocals. Hey, let's try a few of these just to make sure we have a handle on this. I'm going to give you some numbers and let's try to find the negative reciprocals, okay? Because it's a good practice for finding the perpendicular slopes. So if I give you 1/2 and I say find the negative reciprocal of 1/2. Negative reciprocal means that I'm going to flip that fraction over and I'm going to change the sign. So if it's positive, it becomes negative. If it was negative, it would become positive. And I'm going to flip that around. So what's the negative reciprocal of positive 1/2? Sure, negative 2 over 1. Could you just put negative 2? That'd be fine as well. That's fine. Now, as far as thinking about slope, we do like to have the ratio there, right? They say that the rise in this case would be negative 2, go down 2 to the right 1. But you could just write it for your equation as negative 2. Are you with me on this? Okay, let's try some more. How about negative 3/4. What's the negative reciprocal of negative 3/4?
4/3.
It's not negative 4/3 still? So no matter what, we have to change a sign. That negative means you're changing the sign there. So here we're going to have, positive 4/3, for sure. We're going to flip that, and we're going to change a sign. Now, wait a second. What if I just give you a number, like negative 8? Can you still find the negative reciprocal of negative 8? Okay, so we do make the fraction out of it. Very good. And then, like you said, we're just going to flip that thing around. And so positive 1/8 is our answer. Also notice that these things go backwards and forwards. A negative reciprocal of 1/8 is negative 8. Negative reciprocal of 4/3 is negative 3/4. These are negative reciprocals of each other. How many people feel okay about finding the negative reciprocal? Good deal. Now we're ready to go ahead and accomplish this problem. We've talked about parallel. Parallel meant what type of slopes? Good. Perpendicular meant not the same slope, but slopes which are negative reciprocals. So, on your test, you're going to have these types of questions. Chances are you're probably not going to have a whole lot of questions about writing the equation of a line where I give you a point and I give you the slope. More likely, you're going to have the questions where I give you 2 points and say write the equation of y, right? Where you find the slope? This one right here. Where you find the slope and then you use y minus y1 equals mx minus x1. That's one form that you're going to have on the test. The other form that you're going to have on the test is this thing. Find the equation of a line containing a point and parallel or perpendicular to another line. That's what you're going to have, okay? Those two situations there. The first one we dealt with yesterday, this one we're going to talk about right now. So how in the world do we find the equation containing a point and parallel to a given equation? Well, we're back in this situation. We're given the point, the slope, it's not given. We don't have 2 points. We're right down here. We need to solve this equation for y because right there we're going to be able to find our slope. So let's go ahead and do that together. Can you solve this equation for y?
Yes.
How do you do that?
Subtract.
Okay. So if we do that, we do want to write this in a certain order. We like to have our y on the left-hand side, that's normal. But we are going to write the x first instead of after the 5. So we're going to have the negative 3x and then plus 5. Still okay with me so far? Now if we had a number in front of y, this is where we'd be dividing. We divide everything by that number. We don't, so we're okay. We have this in now slope-intercept form. Can you tell me, ladies and gentlemen, what is my intercept, my y-intercept on this equation?
5.
Okay. Now, we're not going to use that. I just want to make sure you're kind of comfortable with that number there. What is the slope for this equation? So my m is negative 3. Yell with me. That's my slope. Now we're looking for, are we looking for parallel or perpendicular in this particular case?
Perpendicular.
Okay, so watch carefully what we do. After we solve this down for our y, we find our slope, and then we look at whether we're looking for the parallel or the perpendicular. Because on your test, I'm not going to give you both, I'm going to give you one of them, either parallel or perpendicular. You have to know what to do. With parallel lines, we're going to keep the slope exactly the same. So what we're going to do on our problem is, after we find the slope here, we're going to say either a parallel slope or perpendicular slope next. We're looking for the parallel slope. What's the slope that's parallel to negative 3? Not perpendicular. The slope is parallel. It's negative 3. That's right. So the parallel slope is exactly the same. So when we're talking about parallel, really we're just rewriting that. We're just rewriting it for parallel. It's exactly the same thing. You okay with that?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so we're just rewriting the parallel to put in our heads that, yeah, we're looking for exactly the same slope. These slopes must be the same. Now, okay, well, we now have the slope we're working with. Our slope's going to be negative 3. What do we do now? Do we have a point?
Yep.
What's our point?
Okay.
I don't even have to use this to find a point. I'm given a point already, right? A specific point will be given to you. It has to be. It will be given to you. Have I found the slope?
Yeah.
No. I think so.
Yeah.
Oh,
yeah.
I think so. So, do I have a point and do I have a slope?
Yes.
What are you going to use?
Parallel.
Hey. That's why those equations are nicely named for us, right? Once you have what you fill out a name with, you fill out the formula as well. So, we're going to use, after this point, y minus y1 equals m x minus x1. Now wait, do we have an M?
Yep.
I want you to look carefully at something. Am I looking to fill this equation out with this M that I found with my formula up here, or with this slope that I'm using here? Now, in this case, they're the same, but when you get to perpendicular, they're going to be different. You understand that, right?
Yes.
Should I be looking here just from this equation, or should I be looking at what I am looking for the problem? This one, really, yeah. Now, in this particular case, since we're talking about parallel, they are the same, right? But if I was looking at perpendicular, I'm not going to go directly from this one. I'm going to look down where it says either parallel or perpendicular slope and use that slope. You with me on this? So here we'll say, okay, I want this slope in that spot. That's what I want. Where are we finding my x1 and my y1, though? Where's that come from? Sure, yeah. I was given a point, right? What's my x1 in this case?
Negative 1.
Okay, somebody else, what's my y1?
2.
I really don't have any other choices on that one, right? I'm only given 1 point, so that has to be there. Let's see if we can plug this in correctly. So I'm going to write inside of the room. Tell me what's the first thing I need to write if I'm going to plug in my equation.
2.
Y minus 2, great. Equals what now?
Negative.
Good. And then what?
X plus 1.
How are you getting the plus 1?
It's negative.
Okay, very good. So we have to include both the minus and the negative. I think we saw that before yesterday as well, right?
Mm-hmm.
So we have to make sure that we have all those signs. We don't lose anything. I'm going to do the extra steps so you see where it's coming from. We have y minus 2 equals negative 3 x plus 1. Raise your hand if you're okay getting that far for me. Good. Now this is the point slope, but oftentimes we like to write this in slope intercept. So we're going to have to go down a little bit further and solve this for y. How do I solve this for y? That'd be a good first step. So we'll distribute that negative 3. So negative 3x and minus 3. And lastly, what are we going to do? Yeah, if we add 2 to both sides, we're going to have solved this for y. That'll be great. That's what we want. I'm going to recap this just a little bit about what you do in this process. First thing you do whenever you write the equation of a line, you look for a point. It should always be given to you, and it is in our case. The next thing you do, because you have to have a point and a slope to write the equation, you look for the slope. If it's not directly given to you, you'll have two options. The first option, or first thing that could happen, is you're given 2 points, in which case you would use your slope formula, which I taught you yesterday, and then you use your point slope. No problem. If you're not given 2 points, what will happen is you'll be given a point and another equation. With that other equation, it will either ask you to be parallel or perpendicular to it. If it's parallel, we solve it for y, slope-intercept form. You take your slope, that's the slope you use. You with me on this? If it's perpendicular, you solve it for y, that's slope-intercept, you take your slope, but then you use the negative reciprocal of that slope. I'm going to show you that in just a little bit. In either case, no matter what, you're going to be using point-slope formula at some point. This is why I said we use this 95% of the time, because these are almost all of our problems are like this. Okay, so that's why we use this so often. After that, we plug in the appropriate numbers, we get our x1, y1 from our point, we get our slope from our equation, we solve that for y, and then if you're asked to graph it, could you graph that?
Yep.
Yeah, you could graph it with a t-table, but that'd kind of take the long way, right? That'd be 3 points, we don't want to do 3 points anymore. What's our y-intercept here? What was that? So we'd go on the x-axis, if you want to see a really quick graph here, we'd go down to -1, we'd put a point on the y-axis at -1. Are you still with me?
Mm-hmm.
What is your slope, ladies and gentlemen?
Negative
what?
-3.
Hey, look it. What's the slope here? -3. What's the slope here?
-3.
Did you do it right?
Yeah.
You can always check, right? Because parallels should have the same exact slope. So we have the same slope here. We know those lines will be parallel. -3 means -3/1. So if we have -3/1, that means from this point you'll go down 3, because it's negative. You'll go to the right. One space is always to the right. And that's how you draw your line. Now I'm going to write another problem up on the board, but I would like you to try one on your own. Let's see if you can make it all the way through on this problem. So same question, write the equation containing that point and parallel to 3x + 4y = 1. So go for it. It's very similar. First, I need you to notice that we are given a point like we always will be given one. Next thing I need you to look for is a slope. If you're not given a slope explicitly, you have one of two situations that you're going to follow. Either you're given 2 points, which we don't have up here, or you're given an equation, which you will need to solve for y. So that's going to be our situation in this case. So lots of people find the slope correctly. That's fantastic. To find the slope, You have to solve that equation for y. To find the slope, you have to solve the equation for y. So when I look at this problem, the first thing I'm noticing is, great, I have a point, that's fantastic, we have to be given one to do the problem anyway. Next thing I look for is my slope. It doesn't just say up there, slope of blank. It doesn't give me 2 points, so I cannot use a slope formula. All I can do is solve this equation for y. Now, the way we do that, hopefully you did this as well, subtract 3x from both sides. Like that, right? You get that far? Now, is our slope negative 3?
No.
Why not? Why not? Can you see how people would make that mistake, though? They just go, oh, the slope's negative 3 because I have x over there now. We can't do that. Why?
Because y is by itself.
That's right. Slope intercept says y is by itself. So if we just stop here, we don't have the right slope yet. What you do have to do, divide everything by that 4. If I divide that by 4, watch carefully, I have to divide this by 4, and I have to divide that by 4. Everything gets divided by 4. Now, these 4s are gone, giving us that y. Over here, you need to know something about negative 3x over 4. You can also write it as negative 3/4 x. That's fine. Plus 1/4. Would you raise your hand and feel okay with getting this far, please? Good. All right, that's fantastic. Are you able to find your slope in this case?
Yeah.
Sure? Yeah. Hey, by the way, I want you to notice something, because people get kind of hung up on this, on the test. Does this or this have anything to do with this problem?
No.
Anything at all? The only reason why we're using this is to get the slope. That's it. That's it. These numbers do not come back again at all. It's just for finding the slope. Nudge your head if you're understanding that. Just for the slope. That's it. What is your slope here?
-1.
So here's our slope. We're looking for the parallel slope. I want you to write that out so that I see that you understand we're looking for parallel here, and then you give me the slope. This will be partial credit on your test. So parallel slope, what is the parallel slope to -3/4, ladies and gentlemen?
-3/4.
Yeah, it should be exactly the same. Parallel means the same. Awesome. Awesome. Hey, what two things do you need to find the equation of any line? What two things?
Point.
Do you have a point?
Yeah.
Do you have a slope?
Mm-hmm.
Sweet, let's do it. How do we find the equation of a line now? What do we use now?
Point.
Yeah, it gives it to you, right? It says you got a point slope, use point slope. Point slope is this one. Y minus y1 equals m x minus x1. We just have to fill that in appropriately. Can you please tell me what is my y1 in this case? Where are you getting the negative 3? Okay, so this is x1. This is y1. So we have y. What are we going to put next?
+3.
And again, where we're getting the +3 is we're really doing minus -3 equals -3/4. And then x minus x1, that's going to be x minus 8. A show of hands, how many people made it to the slope at least? How many people have made it down to this far? That's good, that's very good. Let's see if we made it the rest of the way. Because we are dealing with some fractions here, right? Some people get kind of hung up on some fractions. This isn't really the scope of the class for me to go over how to multiply and add fractions again, but if you need help on that, please come and see me, math lab or office hours, and I'll help you with this stuff, okay? So I'm kind of expecting you to be able to do the fractions. That's, you know, that's the pre-algebra stuff that we're supposed to be able to do a couple classes ago, but I understand that some people have trouble with that. So this will be y+3. We know minus negative is a plus. On the right-hand side, we're going to distribute. And what you're going to get when you distribute is -3/4 x, and then you're going to get plus -3/4 times 8. That's -3/4 times 8 over 1. You can do it 24 over 4, or you can simplify as you go. In any case, you're going to get +6 at the very end of this. Did you get +6? Okay, good. And lastly, we're going to subtract 3. And we're going to have our equation. That's our function. Did you make it down that far? Good, that's really good. help people feel okay about doing this problem, with parallel at least. That's good. Could you graph this if I asked you to?
Yep.
What's your y-intercept?
3.
That means you go up 3. What's your slope?
-4.
And from that point, not the origin, from that point, you'd go up or down, which one?
Down.
Down how many?
3.
And over to the?
Right.
4. How many?
4.
So we have, we go up 1, 2, 3, we put a point there, we go down 3, 1, 2, 3, over 4, put another point, graph our line. Now, we've done two examples of parallel. Let's see how to do perpendicular and see what changes on this. So we're going to have the same question. Find the equation of a line containing 3/4 and perpendicular to that given equation. Of course, we're given a point like we always are. And of course, we're not given 2 points, so we can't find the slope. We're given another equation, so we have to find the slope that way. Let's go ahead and find the slope. To find the slope, what are we going to do first, ladies and gentlemen? That was just lady. That wasn't ladies and gentlemen. We're not quite done yet. What's the last step we have to do on this problem? If we divide by 4, that means everywhere, and we're going to get y equals, let's simplify some fractions as well, negative 2x over 4 is how much? Negative. Plus 5/4. Again, don't be afraid of this. That's not even going to come back in your problem. You're not even going to use that. All we did, this whole process 4, is to find that number right there. That number right there is our slope. So, if we were looking for, hopefully you'll be listening up here, if we were looking for parallel lines, we'd take exactly that slope. Now we're not, because when we read this question carefully, it says, oh, I'm looking for perpendicular. So what we're going to do, why I had you write this and why I had you write that, we're going to also write perpendicular over here. We're going to write perpendicular slope. That's why I made clear that I showed you that we were using this slope, not necessarily the one that we're finding directly from there, because sometimes it's going to change. With parallel, yeah, it's the same, it's perfect. But with perpendicular, if our slope is negative 1/2, what is the perpendicular slope to negative 1/2?
2/1.
Good. So we flip it and we change the sign. Perpendicular slope is 2/1, or you can just put 2. So this one translates down to positive 2/1. We're going to use 2. Hey, do we have a point?
Yep.
Yeah. Do we have a slope?
Yeah.
Are we going to use this slope or this slope? The original one or the perpendicular one?
Perpendicular.
Definitely, because that's why we did this step for parallel and this step for parallel. Now we're doing this step for perpendicular because that's the one we're going to use in our equation now. So we have y minus y1 equals m, x minus x1, and that 2 is what's going into our slope. We use that one. The only reason why we solved that was to find our slope and then find the perpendicular of that. Let's see if we can do this. We're going to have y minus what? Good, because from up here at our point, that's x1, y1. Y minus 4 equals, we know our slope is 2. X minus 3. That's worked out kind of nice for us. All we've got to do now is distribute. Maybe add a 4 to both sides, get this in slope-intercept form, and then think about graphing it if that's what the problem asks you to do. So we've distributed. We'll add 4 to both sides. Ladies and gentlemen, what's our y-intercept here?
2.
We'd go down 2. What is your slope?
2/1.
That means you would go up or down?
Up 2.
Over 1 to the right, draw your line. That'd be just fine. Would you like to try one on your own?
Yeah.
Okay, this involves some fractions, I think. But we should be able to handle those. So we'll do it the same way we just did. So, same thing. Find the equation of the line containing, that's what the dot 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 means, There we go. So go through the same process we just talked about. Identify that you have a point. Of course, we have to be given one. Identify your slope. If it's not given to you and you're not given two specific points, well, then you're going to have to use that equation to find the slope. So do that. Notice whether we're talking about parallel or perpendicular. Write the appropriate slope to that and then use point slope because that's what you'll have. Fast, okay? So while this one looked exactly like the one I just erased, same point, same equation, it's going to be done differently, right? Because we're looking for perpendicular rather than for parallel. Well, let's see what we get when we solve this for our slope. First thing, since we're not given a slope, we do need to use our equation. We will subtract 3x just like we did before. We'll get 4y equals negative 3x plus 1. Also like we had before on this equation, I probably shouldn't have erased it, it was up there. Divide by 4 on every single term, and you get y equals negative 3/4 x plus 1/4. Would you raise your hand if you made it that far? Very good. Okay. Can you identify your slope here? Okay, good. Now we look back at our problem, and we looked whether Mr. Leonard asked you for a parallel slope or a perpendicular slope. In our case, I asked you for... Definitely. So we're going to write down here perpendicular slope. And we gotta figure out what's a perpendicular slope to negative 3/4. How much is that?
4/3.
Good, yeah, we flip it. We also change the sign. And this is the one that's gonna be used right now on our point slope. You see, we have the point, we have the slope. That means we can fill out y minus y1 equals m, x minus x1 with the things that we're given. We have x1, we have y1. We now have our m. Are we going to use this m up here? No, definitely not. We're going to use the one that said perpendicular because that's what our equation is, or that's what our problem is referring to. So we'll do the y minus negative 3. That's going to be in those parentheses because we're subtracting a negative that will eventually change to a plus. Equals 4/3 x minus 8 because x1 is 8. After that, we'll simplify just a little bit before we distribute. We'll have the y plus 3 on the left-hand side, and now we'll get to distribute this thing. On the right-hand side, we'll get the 4/3 x. Then we'll have minus, that fraction doesn't reduce. That's going to be 32 over 3. Do you see how I'm getting 32 over 3? Good, you have 4/3 times 8 over 1. 32 over 3, my goodness. The last step is going to be to do what?
Subtract.
We still have to do that even though you have a fraction over here. So when we subtract 3, we'll get y equals, those 3's are gone. We do get the 4/3 x. But then here we have minus 32/3 minus 3. So do that off to the side if you'd like. You just have to take the sign with it, so the minus, we'll treat that like a negative. Minus 3. Common denominator of 3. Negative 32/3 minus 9/3. That's going to give you negative
40.
That's right. Minus 41/3. Would you like to graph that one?
No.
It's so nice. Yeah, you could though, right? Go down 41/3, whatever that happens to be. And then from there, go up 4 over 3. And that's how you graph that. It'd be kind of nasty to do, because you're dealing with lots of fractions. It's actually not too bad, but you could do it. Hope you'll feel good about parallel and perpendicular. Awesome.